Welcome to another edition of Horse Center, brought to you by Horse Racing Nation and Derby Wars. I'm Brian Zipse, and as always, I'm joined today by my grade one partner, Matt Shifman. How are you, Matt?
Good. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thanks for joining me, Matt. And back in Louisville, of course, we have to mention our executive producer extraordinaire, Ember Marr.
Hi, guys.
Hi, Ember.
Hi, Ember. Matt, it's been a tough week in the world of thoroughbred horse racing. We had some bad news early in the week, and then, of course, tragedy. Wise Dan, the horse that has dominated American turf racing for the last couple of years, Horse of the Year, is out with a minor injury. We don't know if he's coming back, but that'll force him, of course, to miss the Breeders' Cup. Wise Dan.
Yeah, it's one of those weeks in racing. You know, the week before, everything was on the up and up, excitement, and this was a little bit of a tougher week in some regards. But we racing fans, we have to be used to these kind of things.
Yeah, used to the injuries, used to missing horses. I don't think we can ever get used to what happened at Indiana Grand on Tuesday. Late in the card on Tuesday, of course, we lost one of our own. Juan Saez is was a 17-year-old jockey, younger brother to Luis, and he did not survive injuries suffered when his horse fell on Tuesday night. It's especially hard when you have a person of this age. It's especially hard. You know, the accidents happen all the time. We lose people in the world, and you know, something like this on the racetrack, it's just so unexpected and tragic. And you know, he was the leading jockey the first few months that he rode in America. He was the leading jockey at Ellis Park. Everybody has nothing but great things to say about him, and obviously he was a big talent.
Yeah, everything that I read was that he was as talented as he was. He was also a really special kind of kid. So tough loss in the racing world, and it's a dangerous business for all the people that are hands on, that do the day to day things that make the sport that we love.
The permanently disabled jockeys fund is of course a great place to donate, take care of the jockeys that sometimes we do take for granted, and this is a time above all when I think we can look to them and reach into our pockets a little bit. They're taking donations. They're taking donations in honor of Juan. So I think that's something that we can all get behind and use this time of ultimate tragedy to make some good.
Absolutely. That's one of the racing charities that I support on a regular basis.
Amen. All right, let's get back to the week of racing that was, though. There was some good action, and one horse that I'm really excited about, Matt, and she's surprising me. I think she's getting better every week. That's Royal Delta's little half-sister, Crown Queen. Big win in the Grade 1 Queen Elizabeth II Challenge Cup at Keeneland on Saturday.
It was a terrific win. You know, I think when we were looking at the race as a preview, we were very excited about Ball Dancing and the win that she was coming off of, and she put Ball Dancing away coming down the stretch. Ball Dancing started to make a move, and Crown Queen just pulled away, making that win even more impressive.
Let's take a look at that videotape of the Queen Elizabeth II Challenge Cup.
Queen, the leader, just over a quarter mile out. Crown Queen second, Minoret third. Ball dancing has to move wide from fourth. Five lengths off the lead. They've got to catch C Queen. Crown Queen strides forward. Ball dancing third on her outside. Into the final furlong of the Queen Elizabeth II Challenge Cup presented by Lane's End. Crown Queen, the leader. Here's Ball Dancing on the outside. Sister Stroll and Personal Diary run late, but Crown Queen, the leader. Ball Dancing is second. Crown Queen, the million-dollar baby, returns to Keeneland and wins the Grade 1 Queen Elizabeth II Challenge Cup presented by Lane's End with John Velasquez aboard.
So there she is, Matt. She took on the challenge by Ball Dancing. I think Ball Dancing ran every bit the race that she did in her excellent American debut back at Belmont. And she kind of said, sorry, not today, sister. And she was pulling away at the end. I don't know about you, but I suddenly have more hope for the American turf mares, turf fillies at Santa Anita. I think the Europeans are tough. And we still don't know for sure that Crown Queen is going to make the jump up from three-year-old class up into the Breeders' Cup turf. We're waiting to hear the decision from Belmont and Bezalou. But I don't know about you, but I think she could be our best hope if she improves just a little bit more after improving her last three starts so much.
Yeah, I think that Crown Queen is a horse that is improving and could get better. All the other horses are, you know, kind of the usual suspects, and I'm excited about this one. I'm also really happy that Mr. Leone, who's a man that's put a lot of money into the game, spent $1.6 million on this one. I'm glad that he got the big win, and it seems like the investment he made on this horse was a good one, because right now with that Grade 1 and her prospects as a broodmare now are fantastic with that family. So congratulations to him.
Through the roof for sure, and I believe she was $1.6 million even as a weanling. So that's...
Wow.
That's some investment into unproven and young filly. You know what, Matt? I like that performance so much that she is Zat's Star of the Week, Crown Queen.
Good choice.
Thank you. Another horse I was impressed with this week was a two-year-old, a juvenile out in California, and it was only a 6-furlong race. It was only a listed stakes. But this Son of Pulpit, out of a Seeking the Gold mare for Bob Baffert, Lord Nelson, looks like one we need to keep an eye on. Did you happen to catch the Speakeasy this weekend?
I did. They went fast in that race. First quarter was 21 and change. Second quarter, 44 and change. And Lord Nelson sat off the pace a little bit, and coming around the turn, went by those, took those fast fractions and went by and drew off. You know, another good Baffert 2-year-old blazing the Santa Anita racetrack. Interesting to see what this one does.
Last week we talked about Pletcher. This week, of course, Baffert, the other ubiquitous juvenile trainer, this time on the West Coast. The thing I like about him, he was put into the front runner going around two turns in his second start. He came up a little short against American Pharaoh, the likely Breeders' Cup juvenile favorite. But the third race back, he looked good. The thing I like about him is he should stretch out. That breeding says two turns, no problem. I can't wait to see what he does in the future.
Yeah, absolutely.
Going back east, we're shifting here. We went from Keeneland to Santa Anita, back to New York, or back to Illinois, maybe. we both watched with interest the Athenia Stakes Sunday at Belmont, and the turf was had a little give to it, and an old friend of mine, an Illinois bred named Latia, had her day.
Yes, she wire to wire, a great ride. It was Rosario up on Latia, and
Joel Rosario rode her wire to wire.
Fantastic ride. He had ridden her earlier in a race up in Canada, and the track was a little less to her liking. It was a tougher field. He couldn't ration out her speed, but he sure did. He sure did in New York on Saturday.
Yeah, it was a nice win. She just held on, but She's a mare that I think deserved to win a big one on turf for a while. Two starts back before that Woodbine race, I thought she ran a whale of a race in the Beverly D, one of the biggest turf filly races in America, of course, at Arlington Park. And she got beat a length and a half that day after setting all the pace. So I was just really happy to see Latia get her first graded stakes win on turf. She's won several on synthetics already. But those of us in this part of the country know that she's every bit as good on turf. What else did we see? We saw a comeback, an undefeated Florida Derby winner comeback. How did he do that?
Yeah, it was not the kind of start that a lot of people expected from Constitution. But, you know, you got to give the horse and the connections a little bit of slack here. He wasn't coming back in a cupcake kind of race. I know it was just an allowance race, but it was a pretty tough field, mostly older horses. Been off for a long, long time. It's tough to get a horse ready to run against that kind of field, just working out, especially off a layoff. You know, people were pretty quick to like, oh, Pletcher this, another Pletcher bomb, another, you know. And I think we got to give the horse another race and see what he does. I hope we see more the next time.
Yeah, I hope we see more, too. Obviously, a big talent, Pletcher. I know Pletcher just loved him earlier this year. And, of course, he was off 7 months. Broke poorly, as is his penchant, and then set the pace and couldn't hold off a trio of horses as he faded to fourth late. It's nice to see Easter Gift, a graded stakes winner, return to form in his third stake back.
Yeah.
The Constitution, it reminded me a little bit about Cigar Street, who a lot of people are on for the Classic. He came back and got beaten in an allowance race before going to Churchill with a very nice win.
Yeah, we can maybe talk a little bit more about Cigar Street later on in the show.
I think we should. Another horse I've been watching with a lot of interest of late is a turf sprinter, a filly turf sprinter, and I saw her 4 or 5 starts ago. Just really impressive the way she did it, and now she just keeps on going. Her name is Free as a Bird. And she won her 5th straight stakes race. It was Friday in Keeneland in the Franklin County. And she's an interesting filly, Matt. She's gotten really good. I don't know if they're going to pull the trigger and go for the Breeders' Cup Turf Sprint. But as good as she's been lately and kind of under the radar, I think she's one that maybe they should.
Yes, yeah, super cool horse. Off the pace runner. And... super, super consistent over this winning streak. All the buyer speed figures have been right in the same ballpark, and even the races that she didn't win recently were close calls, second place finishes. So, really cool horse. I'd like to see that one in California in a couple weeks.
And she's won 5 in a row, so it hasn't been too recent her losses. I've seen her overcome trouble, and I've seen her do it at different racetracks. Very interesting. We'll have to keep an eye out to see if they go Breeders' Cup with her. All right, Matt. Those were the highlights from last week. But what about your weekly award? I think, what do we call it? The Stud of the Week.
Stud of the Week. This week is gonna once again link into your Zats Star of the Week.
They're connected again.
Yep, we're gonna go with Smart Strike as Stud of the Week. Smart Strike, of course, is the sire of Crown Queen, and Smart Strike is a veteran stallion, 22 years old now, but he's been a heck of a sire, over $115 million in total earnings by his progeny, over 100 stakes winners, over 50 graded stakes winners. Still stands for $100,000 stud fee. So Smart Strike, worthy of some attention.
You're surprising me here, Matt. 22 years old. I had no idea. I remember him coming down from Canada and running at Monmouth. Very nice horse. Curlin, English Channel, looking at Lucky. Australia. Yeah, he's certainly... one of the best sires we've had. I guess now you're telling me in the last 16 years or so. And it seems like a deserving winner of Matt's stud of the week. Absolutely. I wish we could hear that music that Ember pipes in. I love that tune she has. I don't know where she found it. How about we jump right into our top 10? People seem to enjoy our top 10s. We're going to go a little bit off the beaten path for this week's topic. I am starting to get more and more gray hair in my beard and my sideburns as I speak. But you still have me a little bit beaten this area. What's our top 10 list this week, Matt?
We're going to go with the top 10 gray horses of all time.
Of all time. Now, these are runners. This is top 10 runners of all time.
Top 10 runners of all time.
And I think we
had one of our best debates on this one, Brian.
Yeah, you usually beat me on those debates. Let's see if you did today. Yeah. I start this list off with number 10? One of my favorites, Free House. The California-bred Free House was, of course, best known as Silver Charm's foil. They raced 8 times, and Silver Charm got the better of them on 5 occasions. Free House did win 3. Silver Charm, of course, won 2/3 of the Triple Crown, and Free House was 3rd, 2nd, and 3rd in that Triple Crown. He missed the Preakness by a nose. I remember those big expressive eyes. Matt, Free House was a really good runner, and he won a grade one in 4 consecutive years.
Wow, longevity and talent. Impressive. Number 9 is Black Tie Affair. The 1991 Breeders' Cup Classic winner and Horse of the Year in 1991. He won his last 6 races of his career and was so versatile, won at distances from 6 furlongs to 1.25 miles.
Yeah, I remember him early in his career. He was a nice sprinter, his son of Mishawaki, and then who would have thought he would go on to be a Classic winner? Good choice, number 9. Number 8. How about number 8 as a Kentucky Derby winner? I'm talking about Winning Colors. Winning Colors, she had a few inconsistencies in her career, but when she was on, she was something else. The Santa Anita Derby was a blitzkrieg performance by her, and she took it right to Kentucky, beat a big field. 49er and Risen Star were behind her. She's also well known for that great Breeders' Cup distaff. She led every step of the way until the final jump when the undefeated and great Personal Lenson got her in the on the wire at Churchill Downs.
Yeah, that was one of the Breeders' Cup races of all time.
Absolutely.
Number 7 is Silver Charm, one of the many great horses from Bob and Beverly Lewis in those glory years with Dwayne Lucas. As we know, Silver Charm was a narrowly missed the Triple Crown after winning the Derby and the Preakness by very small margins. Lost the Belmont to Touch Gold, but Silver Charm also made the trip over to Dubai and won the World Cup, and ended his career with close to $7 million of earnings.
$7 million for number 7. Well, he's Free House's foil, so I'm not going to cheer you on that one, but I respect Silver Charm greatly. What a horse he was. I'm going to go back to the distaff set, Matt, if you don't mind. I said Winning Colors was 8. How about Princess Rooney at number 6? The good princess. What a 2-year-old she was. She won every one of her juvenile races by daylight. Unfortunately, she got hurt in her first defeat in the Acorn as a 3-year-old. But by the time we got to 4, she was cranking it right back up now under the care of Neil Drysdale out there. And her Breeders' Cup distaff, which was the first ever in 1984, was just a runaway victory, and it was faster than that year's Breeders' Cup Classic. That was back when the distaff was run at 10 furlongs. Princess Rooney, number 6.
Yeah, let's stick with the... Let's stick with the distaff side and go to number 5 with one of my favorites. This horse would be in my my top 10 favorite horses list also. That's Lady's Secret. Lady's Secret maybe was Secretariat's finest offspring.
That's probably the only other one I could think of that would rival her.
Yeah. Ran for 4 years, 45 starts, 25 wins, beat the boys in the Whitney in 1986, and became Horse of the Year that year. So a long career, talented horse, Lady Secret.
Another distaff winner. Well, we could talk about the gray mares all day long, Matt, if you let us, but we got to skip ahead to number four, and I'm gonna offer up the name Holy Bull. Holy Bull won 13 of 16 lifetime. He disappointed in the Kentucky Derby with a little controversy, but he was also Horse of the Year as a three-year-old. Who can forget his game win in the Travers? Came back with a huge win in the Woodward. Unfortunately, he was injured when he first faced Cigar in the Don Handicap, but as a two-year-old and three-year-old, Holy Bull was nothing but brilliant.
Yeah, he was a good one. New Jersey-based, made him even more special. Number three, favorite of many, many people, Skip Away. Skippy, as he was affectionately known, won almost $10 million, $9.6 million in his career. He won four Eclipse Awards during his career, was Horse of the Year in 1998, and I found this statistic was just amazing. He set 10 records, 10 stakes records in the course of his career. That's just amazing. Another 29 buyer speed figures over 100 after his two-year-old season.
Just like your last one, another Iron Horse. I was a fan of Skip Away. Another with New Jersey connections.
Yes.
He was something, but he wasn't as good as my number two. In fact, my number two is on a short list of my top two of all-time horses I've ever seen. Number two is, of course, Spectacular Bid. And his name says it all, Matt. He was spectacular. The two-year-old champion, the three-year-old champion, the older horse champion, the Horse of the Year. Spectacular Bid did it all. And talk about records. He had a streak in California that I think we should run a little video here. Can you run that for us, Ember?
Spectacular Bid, second, three parts of a length. Valdez on the outside, third, and Flying Pacer. They're tightly bunched as they turn for home, but the Bid gets the lead. Spectacular Bid in front by two, relaunch on the rail. Here comes the Pacer, now up into the second spot, and down the stretch they come. It's the Bid in front by 2.5, and the Pacer trying to close the gap. They race for the wire. Spectacular Bid in front, under the wire with Phil Shoemaker in 157.
So that was Harvey Pack talking about all of the records that Spectacular Bid was setting in California as a four-year-old. Track records, every race, world record, carrying big weight. You know, Matt, he set a track record as a two-year-old around two turns. Just a phenomenal horse. Of course, he was beaten in the Belmont. There's the safety pin, the infection that he had after it. Ron Franklin wasn't... Yep. Wasn't always giving him the best rides, but for my money, Spectacular Bid was just about as good as anybody. So who could be better than Spectacular Bid?
Who could be better than Spectacular Bid of in all time? The Grey Ghost, Native Dancer. And as I mentioned earlier, Brian and I debated about this one. We debated in email, we debated in texting, we debated on the phone about this one quite a bit. But Native Dancer is number one. The Grey Ghost was a favorite across the country. Native Dancer came around at a time when everybody just had black and white TV, and the beautiful gray coat showed up on those black and white TVs with tremendous contrast, and the country fell in love with him. And of course, besides that, he only lost once, won 21 out of 22 times. His only loss, of course, was in the Kentucky Derby in a race that was a pretty controversial race. He got roughed up a good bit in there, and back in the 50s, you were allowed to rough him up a little bit more than today. And when he finally got clear, he made a big, big, big run and almost got there in the Kentucky Derby, but went on and won all the rest of his races, and was Horse of the Year the following year, actually, amazingly, in 1954, and number one, Native Dancer.
Yeah, and Tom Poole, I guess, won the Horse of the Year. Older horse, great horse, Hall of Famer Tom Poole won it Native Dancer's year. But Native Dancer is one of the few horses to win Horse of the Year as a juvenile. So while I love Spectacular Bid, I'll give you Native Dancer at number one, Matt. Well done.
Okay, thank you, Brian.
Let's jump ahead to what we have coming this weekend. I think it's I think we'll be looking outside the border of the United States a little bit for some of the bigger races, and there's the big happening in Ascot on Saturday is the English Champions Day with a host of Group One races. The biggest race of all the races is the Champions. And we lost a few due to the course conditions. It's going to be very soft, much like a big chunk of the United States. They're getting a lot of rain over there in the UK, and you know that's not going to hurt the horse to beat in the Champions. Cirrus de Zegla is a special horse. We talk about some of the great geldings we've been afforded the last few years. Wise Dan and Game On Dude, yep, to name a couple, but this guy is something special as well. 8 years old and still going strong. Matt, he's collected almost 6 million pounds, which is translates pretty well to American dollars these days.
Yeah.
And he's finished first or second more than 40 times in his stellar career.
And this is his fourth consecutive start in the Champion Stake.
Is that right?
Yes.
You got me there. I did not know that, but
yeah, I think he won it in 2011, and I think it's his fourth consecutive start.
Well, look for it to be his second win, very likely. I think as an 8 year old, he's already put together 3 Group One wins this year. He looks as good as ever at 8, and like I said at the beginning, he just loves it when that turf is a little wet. So he could be the star of the day.
Might be nice if some of those horses that aren't running on the wet grass over there now decide to make a trip across the ocean.
Well, yeah, that might open the door for a few more. We're going to wait to hear. But one horse I think that it did open the door more for, and also the fact that Wise Dan won't be in the mile, is Toronado.
Yeah.
Toronado is the best older miler in Europe. In fact, let's throw the videotape of the Prix de Moulin de Longchamp up, where we had a great finish between three of the best milers. Now that Kingman's been retired, this was Charm Spirit beating Toronado and Knight of Thunder, but all three came down to the wire almost together. We'll see two of them. The first place finisher, Charm Spirit, the third place finisher, Knight of Thunder. Saturday in the Queen Elizabeth II there at Ascot, and the horse in the middle is the older one, Toronado. He's going to be coming for the Breeders' Cup mile this year, and he's going to be, I'm pretty sure, he'll be the mile favorite.
Yeah, I think with Wise Dan gone, I think that's going to be a foregone conclusion.
Yeah, he's the one to beat. It'll just be a matter of whether he takes his best racing to Santa Anita and the firm turf at Santa Anita. All right, Matt, so we have a plan for Saturday morning viewing from jolly old England, Champions Day. What about back here? We have, up north of the border, I guess the biggest race in North America happens near Toronto. The Canadian International is on Sunday. You like anyone in the International?
I don't know, Brian. I haven't had a chance to look at the PPs very much for that one yet. I think they just drew the field today.
Yeah, they drew a field of 10, Matt. You got your Illinois-bred friends of mine, the Pizza Man and Sun Tracer, an old friend of yours, Big Blue Kitten, who I think win at Monmouth last year. You also have a couple tough Europeans coming over in Hillstar and Brown Panther. Brown Panther won the Irish St. Ledger last time, mile 3/4, very impressively. But Hillstar might be actually the one to beat. He's the horse I think is the most likely winner. He's a little younger. He's a four-year-old. Brown Panther is a well-traveled six-year-old. Hillstar's been running very well in these distance races in Europe and comes in off several straight races where he's been first or second. So he'd be my top pick over there, although I would love to see, especially the Pizza Man, love to see one of my Illinois breds do well up there.
Canadian International, famous for Secretariat's last start.
That was his last start, that's right. His final two races were on the turf, yeah. They also have the New Arctic Grade 1. They have the E.P. Taylor for the fillies and mares. So it'll be a big day. In fact, Matt, it's such a good day at turf. I think I'm going to put something up on Horse Racing Nation, some sort of pick four, using some of those stakes races so people can see more of my selections there.
Excellent. Have you ever been to Woodbine?
Of course I've been to Woodbine. Woodbine's a nice track. It's outside of Toronto there. I really like Woodbine. I haven't been, unfortunately, for years. But, yeah, they do it right. It's definitely the best racing in Canada. Beautiful turf course. I didn't see the Breeders' Cup up there. But they're one of the best racetracks in North America, and I strongly suggest a visit up there if you haven't been there yet. Have you been there?
No, but actually there was a little conversation in the house about maybe a trip this summer. So I like to add them to my list. And that turf course, of course, in our country is unique because the grass course is outside of the main track.
Yeah, turf is probably the thing up there, although, yeah, the main track, of course, has the Queen's Plate. I'd also mention that if you do the visit, I think you should. Toronto's a really nice city to stay in. It reminds me a lot of Chicago, actually, right on the lake there. So I have
to Toronto, but the racetrack. Toronto. And you might wonder how the heck that happened, but
that happened.
That's another story.
Okay. We'll talk about that off the off the air, so people don't need to hear all our dirty laundry. Big race, Keeneland's getting just swamped with rain all week. They have turf racing stake today, the Sycamore stake tomorrow, the Valley View, I believe it is. But they're certainly their best race of the week is Saturday's Raven Run, Matt, and you have a slew of good filly sprinters in there. What do you think about Misbehavior? You followed her a little bit. You saw her last win at Charlestown where she just blitzed the field.
Oh, yeah, that was certainly an amazing race. And I hope that one can have another big race and should be a good one.
Yeah, it should be a good one. I think I did a little more handicapping for this one than you had a chance to yet. Matt, there's just a bunch of good fillies. Cassatt, coming from the Monmouth Oaks and the Cotillion. You got Terrace, who I was very interested in earlier in the year, just came back with a good repeat performance. Thank You Mary Lou, bombed him at Churchill last time. So it's a deep, talented field of fillies, and I think Misbehavior, the favorite, I imagine, will have her hands full in there at 7 furlongs at Keeneland. So that's another one to watch for this week. We should start talking about the Breeders' Cup a little bit, though, right? Breeders' Cup is what, 2 weeks?
2 weeks.
2 weeks. The Breeders' Cup Classic right now, I looked on HRN Stakes Tracker, and I saw that there's 16 probable possibles right now listed on the Stakes Tracker at HRN. The three-year-olds are kind of the ones that most people are paying attention to. Who's your top long shot? Who's your top pick right now? What are you thinking of the classic field?
I've mentioned and written some things here and there about the classic, and right now I got a little notion that maybe it's not going to be a three-year-old that wins the classic. I know that's sticking your neck out, and I'm going to stick it out a little bit at this point, but I think we could get a big, big price in the Classic this year, and certainly if one of those three-year-olds doesn't win it, it's going to be a big price. And I just started to look a little bit, and I mentioned earlier in the show, there's a little bit of something about this Cigar Street that I like. So those are my early thoughts. I mean, we've got a great article up about the Classic on Horse Racing Nation right now that's whipped up a little bit of discussion in the comments section by the article written by Ashley Tamulonis. So if you haven't read that, I think you should read that and jump in on the comments there. What are you thinking, Brian?
Yeah, Ashley was talking about, it was a good article. She was talking about shared belief, possibly becoming joining Zenyatta as only the second undefeated winner. And I'm kind of into that. I think shared belief is really good. However, as a handicapper, as a gambler, as the favorite, I think there's good reason to think he's vulnerable. Tonalist interests me. I can't completely throw out the other three-year-olds, Byron, California Chrome, of course. And I think any of them are reasonable Horse of the Year candidates if they win that. So that's interesting. I'm looking at ralliers, maybe. It looks like there's going to be a fair bit of speed. Moreno, Big Casanova, with Byron on their tail. So that could set it up. Zivo? What if Zivo comes to California and likes that track as good as he's been lately? He had a lot of trouble in the Jockey Club Gold Cup, if you remember. Yes. Cigar Street is interesting. He was really talented when he was getting good early in his four-year-old year. So he's one to watch now as a five-year-old, a returning five-year-old. I'm holding on. I liked Candy Boy all year. He hasn't won a race since the Robert Lewis in the winter. I just think he might run a big race. I was impressed with his Pennsylvania Derby rally from last to just miss second. I don't think Candy Boy's going to win the Classic, but maybe rally up at high odds for a piece of the superfecta, exacta, trifecta possible for Candy Boy. Anything else on this Classic?
Yeah, I think it's a really intriguing race and so many different ways to look at it in terms of the way you want to wager.
Yeah, it should be a fun race to watch, a fun race to bet. And you know, Matt, of all the Breeders' Cup races, we've had a lot of defections, of course, in the last month or two or more. I think of all of them, the Breeders' Cup Classic is the one I'm most interested in seeing because it really truly does have a lot of Eclipse Award ramifications, probably Horse of the Year ramifications. It also is pretty intriguing as far as what's going to happen because it's bringing together a nice mix, and like we already said, it should be a good betting race. Is this the Breeders' Cup race that you're looking forward to, or do you have one that's really on your list right now?
Well, I'm all, you know, in that sequence, and of you know, I don't think we know the exact sequence of the races yet. They sometimes tinker with them right at the end, but I think the turf is going to be, will certainly be in that last pick four on Saturday. And I think that's going to be a really intriguing race also. You know, the way the race sets up, the field, the European versus USA angle, I've really gotten into that race with that being my coverage race for Horse Racing Nation. I think it's a really cool race. It's interesting if you go and look back at the way they've run at Santa Anita. This is going to be the eighth time now on the turf at Santa Anita. So there's a lot of back form that you can go look at. So I'm really enjoying the history of it and looking ahead. And as you guys all know, I'm a big main sequence fan. Still am.
You love main sequence, and there's no reason not to with his record in America. I like him a lot, too. I think his races have been dynamite, the way he finishes with such a flourish. Telescope is a serious racehorse, Matt, and I think he's probably better than, comparing the two divisions, I think he's probably better than Toronado. So Telescope is going to be a tough nut to crack if he comes over and runs his best race. But, yeah. The turf should be fun. For me, I want to leave this parting shot with everyone. It's going to be weird to be at the Breeders' Cup. It's only been a couple of years. Actually, I saw him once in the sprint, too. But Wisedan, you know, we expected him to be in the mile for the third straight time. Everybody was looking forward to it. So Wisedan is going to be a horse that I really miss at this year's Breeders' Cup in Santa Anita.
Yeah, it takes a little bit of the glamour and the American edge and so many things off of it, but We'll manage without him.
We will manage. That's right.
Yeah. And my parting shot is going to be continuing with the Breeders' Cup. 2 weeks out. I'm starting to think about the Breeders' Cup a lot now. I'm starting to formulate some ideas, think about races that I might be concentrating on in terms of wagering and when I'm going to do a pick four and what kind of race might set up to be a good trifecta race. To me, that's so much a part of the fun of the Breeders' Cup. So we're only 2 weeks out.
It's exciting, Matt. I'm with you. Betting these races, I when I get a chance to really handicap it a week ahead of time, I usually do better. So yeah, let's formulate those multi-race wagers and those superfectas early. Get them down. Really know what we like. We can adjust a little bit with scratches and post positions and maybe even a track bias or two. But let's do the homework early and get on that Breeders' Cup handicapping job like we should. Let's do our homework.
I think that's such a huge part of being successful at the Breeders' Cup, because it's a tough task to do well at the Breeders' Cup with those kind of fields and horses getting primed to run big. But you really have to go into it with a strategy, identify races, how you're going to wager certain races, and keep in mind, you don't have to bet every race.
Look for
the race where you're most comfortable, where you think you've got a good wagering plan, and focus on them.
Well said, Matt. Good advice.
As always, thank you for joining us on Horse Center, everyone. Thank you, Matt, for joining me. Always a pleasure.
It's a pleasure every minute of it. And I also want to thank, we've been getting some great comments from viewers on the blog or wherever, on Twitter, and we appreciate that. So please keep up with the comments.
Say goodnight, Ember.
Goodnight, Ember.
Goodnight, Ember.